Well, it started about two or three years ago, I think, in a smaller way, and it's slowly grown. And then I think we reached our peak in this summer, in the middle of this summer, in July and August, when we traveled 31 cities in 5.5 weeks. And I thought I was insane doing this, and I'd never ever recover. And it was the best, I think it was the best 5.5 weeks I think I've ever had in my life.
Because?
You just, it was like one great big camp. The orchestra, 35-piece orchestra, and we were all like kids, all getting on these aircraft every morning or at 7 o'clock in the morning. And you couldn't help but, I mean, it sounds stupid, but you couldn't help but have fun, because you had to have fun. If you didn't laugh, you'd cry.
This is a pure concert. There's no costuming. It's just sing the songs of Andrew Lloyd Webber.
Yes, in a tux.
And do you, in a tuck, do you do songs that you have not sung previously on stage of his?
Yes, I do. I do Gethsemane from Jesus Christ Superstar, and I do Love Changes Everything from Aspects of Love, and I do Tell Me on a Sunday.
And in the album is what you put everything that you do on the stage with the Royal Philharmonic?
Yes, the album has all these and then about seven others.
What is it like to sing with the Royal Philharmonic?
It was... I'd already done one album called The Phantom Unmasked, which is with the London Symphony Orchestra, which is a great, great orchestra. And I didn't think anything really could be any better, but this actually was. And we recorded it at Abbey Road Studios, where the Beatles did all their stuff. And it's a terrific studio, the acoustics there, unlike anything I think I've ever performed in. And you can hear it, because as I'd rehearsed the stuff and worked the stuff quite a bit, most of it is live with the orchestra in that studio, with very few edits.
Ah, no dubbing in?
No, so it was unusual and exciting to do that.
You're a great singer. Are you better when the orchestra's better?
Everybody's... If you have a show where you're all good, everybody's that much better. I mean, we had a great company in the summer. They've all gone off and done, they're doing Broadway shows now and gone on to greater things. We have a new company who are young and enthusiastic, and the better the people you have around you, the better you'll be, and the better that you each fire off each other. It's like a good team, a good football team.
Yeah, the better the opponent, too.
Yes.
Yeah. Michael, how do you react to all that has happened to you? I mean, you have become internationally famous, worshipped, renowned, people covet you. I mean, it's like insane. How have you taken to all of this?
You don't really, in the light of day, you don't really react to it. It's something that you know you have to get up every day, the same as everyone else, and you know you have to go in and sing as well, at least, as you did the night before. And unless you do, you start to go backwards, and people say, oh, I didn't think he was as good as him. I thought he might be, I never want to be that.
Well, how about the fame?
Well, it's again, I think, beyond my wildest dreams that what has happened, and you never realize with whatever show you do what kind of success you're to expect, if any. I mean, I've experienced enough failure, so...
Yeah, I know, everyone has. But I mean...
But that's good for us. That's,
you know,
that's
that
a
worldwide,
good foundation.
Worldwide, people say, if phantoms coming to your city, do you have Michael Crawford? Is Michael Crawford doing it? I mean, you know that. You are intertwined with that role.
Well, that's a nice feeling. That's a nice thing to hear.
How'd you get it?
How did I get the role? I think it was I'm not altogether ever believed in being in the right place at the right time. I've always said to people, no, if you've got talent, nothing will stop you.
Talent
You'll be
will
okay.
Out.
Talent mm-hmm. will out. And it seemed to be taking a long time with me.
I saw you in Hello, Dolly. You were like a young
yes.
guy in that.
We were both young guys.
Yeah. Years ago.
And it was, I was at a singing lesson. And Sarah Brightman, who was married then to Andrew Lloyd Webber, had the same singing teacher. And they came along one day early for her lesson. And I was upstairs singing an Italian aria. And Andrew Lloyd Webber heard me. And I think that's when he first
just
thought
like
of me for The Phantom, yes.
Did he say something to you then?
No, he didn't. He didn't. I mean, he asked me about doing it, being in the show, about a year and a half before he actually came finally and said, I'd like you to sing this for me and see what it sounds like. Because I think his original conception was a rock opera.
Oh, really?
Because the first piece of music he wrote was The Phantom of the Opera, the title song, and that is unlike any other piece in the show, yeah, in a way. It's very rocky, and he had a rock singer performing it, and they made a video of it. And I thought, well, goodbye, Michael, that's obviously I'm not in mind for it. And then after a long, long break, he called me, and I went in and sang.
When you rehearsed it, first, the idea of playing it where the audience would never see your face. You don't even take the bows, right? You don't take any makeup off, right?
No, you so take the bows as the Phantom.
So when you would leave the dressing room, people didn't know who was who, right?
No.
They didn't know you.
No. My own dresser, after about 7 months, I went to a party with a company. My dresser used to come in at 6 in the evening and leave at 10, and I came in at 4 in the afternoon and left at 11. And one day, he picked me up from my apartment to go to a party for the company. And when I came out, he didn't know who I was.
We'll be right back with Michael Crawford. He's touring now, and the album is out, the music of Andrew Lloyd Webber, the brilliant star of Phantom of the Opera. Don't go away.
And listen to the music of the night.
With Michael Crawford, the brilliant star of Phantom of the Opera. How long does it take to put on the makeup every night?
Started out when we first worked on it about 3 hours, because you had to create it and find some way that you could sing and breathe and hear, and they were pretty important. So you have to be able to hear, because otherwise you can't hear you can't do that, because you can't sing like that.
Yeah.
You can't put something in your ear, because you can't hear the orchestra. So you had to work around everything. So we made him kind of Valentino, this side, Valentino-ish, and very elegant and very Latin. And then this side, obviously, had to be the disfigured side. But there's only so far you can go in a theatre. Beyond 7 rows, you're not going to see too much detail.
Back to the where you never you couldn't take makeup off for the bows. Was
no.
It just physically impossible to do that?
Yes.
What did that do to your ego? I mean, didn't you want? I mean, the recognition that goes with the territory. They say
not
didn't
for
you?
My face, no, for my talent. I appreciated it. To hear the applause.
So
is
you would be happy, say, walking down the street and hearing people go right by and not know you're in Mike Crawford, and saying, "Boy, did you see that guy?"
Yes. No, I'm delighted when that happens. I mean, I could still buy my sneakers in Kmart.
Did you know in rehearsal this was a hit?
You do have a good feeling about certain pieces of work that you do, but I've had that about 3 pieces, and one of them lasts 6 weeks, and the others have lasted 5 years and 5 years, so I was wrong.
What was the other one you had?
The one was Flowers for Algernon, which was based on the movie Charlie, which we did, and I got the best reviews I'd ever got for anything, and it ran 6 weeks. But Andrew saw me do that as well, and that's one of the things that helped me get Phantom.
And the other hit was Dolly?
No, Barnum. I did Barnum in England for 5 years.
You did Barnum?
Yes, yeah.
Who did it over here?
Jim Dale did
Jim
it
Dale
in America.
Did. Was that fun to do?
It's funny, because he's an American character, and I think it ran for 18 months here, and we ran for 5 years in England.
They looked with all the clowns?
They loved it, yes. The English just adored it.
Did you love that music in Phantom right away?
Yes. The minute he played the overture, my hair stood on end at the back of my head. And it was, you knew, because I had no idea how to play the man. And
no idea?
No idea whatsoever. When it started, what had I seen? I'd seen Lon Chaney.
Yeah.
And that's all at this kind of speed. And you think, well, wait a minute, slow down. I've got to see where this character comes from. But the best thing to do is to read the book, and that's where I found where he came from. I don't think any other film came near. I think the Lon Chaney version was by far the best.
Are they doing a movie or the musical?
I hope so. It's been talked about, but there are productions of this all over the world, so I think there's sort of money to be made for the producers.
Are you getting the movie? Do you know you will do the movie?
Yes, I've been asked to do the movie.
It would be crazy not to have you do the movie.
Well, touch wood. We'll just, you never know.
All right, singing that song every night, did it ever get old hat?
No, and it still doesn't. I sing it every night in the concert, and every night I go out there, and it's like the beginning of the world again, to start, to actually take that first breath. It's such a special song to sing, Music of the Night.
Oh, yeah.
And it's such a hard song to sing, to do with the valleys and the hills that you have to climb and descend throughout the song, to do them smoothly and romantically and
all pop singers try to do it now at the end of their act. They try. Sammy Davis did it very well.
Yes,
did
yes.
Did you see him do
yes,
it?
Yes, bless his heart.
He did it
yes.
very well.
He was in. He used to come and see us a lot.
Now you've played it in London, yeah. New York, Los Angeles. Where else?
Nowhere else. I did a year in each, and a year and a half in Los Angeles.
Have you gone to see others do it?
No, I haven't. No.
By deliberate?
By choice, yes. I mean, I wouldn't want to go and see myself do it. He's something that's so close to me. He's someone that's so close to me, the characterization, the way I built it and created him, that he's dear to me. And it's
so you don't want to see him belong to anyone else?
No, not my version, yeah. But they'll have their, I mean, everyone else has got their own version, which are vastly different from each other, which is good. So people can go and see different productions and enjoy them equally as much.
How about the stage effects? Were they easy to work around? Chandeliers coming down and all the things that go with this kind of modern musical?
Yes, they were after the second year. I don't think they were in the first week when you suddenly had a candlestick going up your trouser leg and you tried to walk away.
Oh, they had goofs, huh?
Oh, yes. I mean, terrible goofs. And
what was the worst goof?
I think when I came on very seriously and in the boat at the beginning, which you keep seeing excerpts of me in the boat with Christine, and the boat got stuck, and there's a guy in the wings with a, you know, those toy cars that you can go and
they, yeah, yeah, the boat control.
That's all he's got. I mean, he's got this toy boat control, and we're in this great big iron boat, and it stopped. So I'm still standing very carefully. I think, geez, I've got to get out. So you can't move this seriously, and you're singing. So I get out the boat, and I turn around, and I pick the girl out, and I move her in front of me so that now I'm walking towards the audience, and the boat is behind me, and the girl is in front of me. Christine is there. Suddenly, the boat starts to work again. So the guy's got it going, and it comes right up behind me, and the lantern goes right between my legs. Well, I was lifted straight off the ground, and of course, all you can hear are people in the wings going, and this dreadful noise, and you can't laugh because you blow completely.
So you go on.
Yes, you go on with this canoe between your legs.
They got the Phantom in a different place. Michael Crawford is our guest, the music of Andrew Lloyd Webber, back after this. With the brilliant Michael Crawford. In fact, when I heard that you were the star of Phantom and I heard the music, I said, gee, that guy's great. And then I saw you on Broadway a long time ago in Dolly, right?
No, Black Comedy.
Black comedy, but I saw you young guy. You were young.
Yes, yes.
You were like a kid almost.
Yes.
You were young.
I was young. I was about 22,
23. That was Dolly, right?
No, Black Comedy.
Okay, and you played?
It was a farce by Peter Schaeffer on Broadway. I did Dolly the movie. I did the movie version of Dolly with Barbara Streisand.
Right, and you played who in that?
Cornelius Hackle, the young Clark.
Right, but we didn't know about that voice. Did your voice change?
Yes, I got kicked very badly once by a horse.
I mean, you were like remember you was like a freckle-faced sort of red-headed kid.
Yes, that's right. I started singing lessons about 16 years ago. And then I really started to work.
You mean you didn't know then you had a voice?
No. I didn't know I had this voice until about 6 years ago, 5 years ago. And now as recent, I mean, the new album, it sounds entirely different to the voice that I did the Phantom soundtrack. I mean, if you keep working for 3 or 4 hours, I still work for 2 hours a day, every day
really?
Of my life. I may take Sundays off.
If I would have heard you sing then, what would it have sounded like?
A sort of pain giraffe or something like that. I mean, it was pretty bad. It was just a simple, pure voice. I mean, as a boy soprano, that's how I began. But then, as I got a little older, it just developed into a simple, plain, light voice, which Cornelius Hackle, I mean, he sings It Only Takes a Moment, and pretty songs like
Takes a Moment. Yes.
That's a beautiful song.
Yes, it is a beautiful song. And in Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum with Zero Mostel and Phil Silvers and Jack Guilford, I sang You're Lovely, I mean, it was a thing. And I had these skinny little legs.
You were always the boy kind of, not eunuch, yes. You were the boy romantic.
Well, yeah, eunuch, yes, I sounded like a eunuch.
You sounded like a eunuch, but you were like the kid. I saw you in Forum, too.
Yes.
I didn't know I knew you. This is a whole new you.
Yes, okay. It's like a new life. It's
what about the sex appeal aspect of this, the feminine attention, women all over the world, that kind of thing? What's that like, Michael?
Well, I read about it, but I don't really come into contact with it.
You don't have Crawford groupies?
Yes, there. I have fans that will follow us across country, and that, I mean, which is wonderful. I mean, I really loved the fact that when we opened recently in Florida, they came from California. Well, we're going to Philadelphia and Minneapolis.
There are people who've seen you do Phantom 20 times.
Yes.
Do you know that people who've seen you do it 20 times?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
when you have that kind of impact on people, that Danny Kaye once told me that there's a plus to that, but there's a minus. It's a little scary to be that kind of an impact in a person's life.
It is. It's funny that Danny Kaye, you mentioned Danny Kaye, was the person, I suppose, when I was 9 years of age, that I went into the London Palladium and I saw, and from that moment on, I knew something. There was something about a stage that I wanted to have something to do with. And he influenced my entire life, Danny Kaye.
Really?
Yeah. Him and Gene Kelly were the two biggest influences of my whole career. Because Gene directed Hello, Dolly, and was the most generous and helpful man that I've ever worked with in my life. But, yes, there are pluses with fans, wonderful pluses, because without them, we don't have any bottom sitting on seats to come and see us. We don't have any viewers watching the television to see us, to appreciate our
work. But when it's adoration, isn't that...
Well, what I've done with we have a fan association, and the type of people that are involved in it are not necessarily people who would join a fan club.
Middle-aged women?
Oh, they're not all, they're any age. I mean, we have 80, 90-year-old people in it, and we have 7, 6, and 5-year-olds, but we have them working for children around the world, so that whatever money goes into the fan club, we educate children till they're 12.
We'll be back with our remaining moments with the wonderful Michael Crawford on Larry King Live right after this. Yes, Michael Crawford touring with the music of Andrew Lloyd Webber and the album out with the Royal Philharmonic. Where do you go from here? What do you do? What kind of parts come to you?
Well,
there ain't Phantoms.
If we do the movie of Phantom maybe next year, and if not, I want to continue singing. So I want to go on doing the tour with Andrew Lloyd Webber's music, and then maybe a tour of my own with music from other things, contemporary music. And
at the same time, would you also look for a new musical to do?
I don't think I'll rush into doing another musical. I did Barnum for 5 years in England. I've done Phantom for 3.5 years. I mean, that's a lot of work on a stage. And so I'd like a rest from the stage for just a little while, and maybe find the right movie to do. But I'd rather not rush. You choose to do bad ones at one point, and you know you're not good in them or something. So therefore, it's best to leave them alone and stay on the stage.
Would you do Phantom again, other than the movie?
Oh yes.
Do it on stage again?
Yes, yes. I never say that I wouldn't. But not for a bit.
What a delight finally to have you with us.
Thank you very, very much, Larry.
Michael Crawford, the genius, the brilliant star of Phantom of the Opera, touring with the music of Andrew Lloyd Webber. Thanks for joining us. World News is next on this edition of Larry King Live. Good night.